Okay, I think we're about ready to get started. Can everybody hear me okay? Okay, I'll try my best. We'll turn it off here in a second. Give us 1 minute, we'll work on the volume here. Is that any better?
Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you for your patience. All right, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Kevin O'Connell. I'm the campus administrator here at Geer. Welcome. We're delighted to have you here today. We've been anticipating this program for a very long time, and we're thrilled to welcome you all. In just a few minutes, we'll be having a talk by Deborah Solomon. After her talk, we'll have a question and answer period, and then that will be followed by a book signing. When the program is complete, if you'd like to take a tour of Geer Village, we would love to show you. We're very proud of you. Just meet us in the back by the piano, and we'll take you for a tour. This afternoon, we are delighted to present Deborah Solomon. Ms. Solomon is a longtime New York Times Magazine columnist, art critic, and acclaimed biographer. Ms. Solomon will be speaking about her new book entitled American Mirror, the Life and Art of Norman Rockwell. Ms. Solomon is the author of two previous biographies of American artists, Jackson Pollock, a biography in Utopia Parkway, and the life and work of Joseph Cornell. She has written about art and culture for many publications. Her weekly interview column, Questions For, appeared in the New York Times Magazine from 2003 until 2011. She currently serves as a New York Times, as an art critic for WNYC in New York, where she lives with her family. And it is with great pleasure that I present to you today, Deborah Solomon.
Gracious introduction. Can everybody hear me? Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Thank you all for coming today. What a turnout. I didn't know there were this many people in Northwest Connecticut. Thank you so much. So I wrote a biography of Norman Rockwell, and it was really a thrill because my background is in traditional art history, meaning I was an art history major in college. And the name Norman Rockwell never came up once in all my years studying art history. He was seen as a lowly calendar illustrator. And art historians paid no attention to him at this point. He was excluded from the canon. So instead, when we studied American art, we were taught that Jackson Pollock represented the absolute height. Is that John? John, what are you doing here? Oh, no, I have to be careful about what I say because he lives in my building and he knows everything. Okay. I'll make sure I get my facts right. In college we were taught that Jackson Pollock represented the height of American art, and that abstract painting represented art at its most adventurous, and that art that merely told stories was seen as very regressive, almost not really art, because the whole idea of storytelling was derided in the 20th century as being less exciting than art that was about pure form. If you think about who was celebrated in the 20th century, you think mostly of abstract artists from Picasso on down, right?
Yeah.
So poor Norman Rockwell was seen as a square. He, my slideshow is not quite working, but this is enough. I think this is enough in terms of capturing why we remember him. I had the best time working on this book. I spent 11 years on it. And spent a lot of time. Hello?
We're having a lot of problems hearing you, so she's going to give you a lapel mic.
Okay. Is the mic not working? Or am I not plugging it?
That's more back.
Okay.
Let's see if that will work.
Okay. Hello? Is that better or worse?
Worse.
Okay. Both? Both mics?
Okay, now, better or worse?
Worse.
Worse, it's like the eye doctor.
Try the microphone again.
We'll try this one. This is better, isn't it? This is much better. Okay, so, yeah, so I spent about a decade working on the book, a little longer, and I never really like to tell people how much time I spent working on the book. You know, because some women won't tell their age. It's like, I won't tell the exact amount of time I spent on my biography. It's embarrassing because people must think either I'm very slow or obsessive. But I did spend a long time working on it. And it was just, it was the most fun I ever had working on the book. In part because I felt like there was so much to unearth and not that much had been done. It's like, why do another book on Picasso? There are already probably 100 books on Picasso. Compared to Norman Rockwell, who really has not been as covered, I think, as he should be and will be over time. Lately, also, before we get into his personal history, you know, his works came up at auction last fall in New York and sold for much more than they had previously. So it's interesting that the market for his work is rising. If any of you own original Norman Rockwells, you're in the money. Yeah. Anyone here, you have one or had one?
I have one.
Good. Hold on to that. Don't sell it. So in general, I feel like there's been a real rise in appreciation for artists who do things other than make abstract paintings. I think any artist who's a storyteller, whether it's a landscape painter or a genre painter or a figure painter, portrait painter, I feel like all of that is gaining more attention now in New York City, that nobody any longer thinks that abstract painting represents the apex of art. So, Rockwell, for those of you who don't know, was born in New York City, on the Upper West Side, where I live and where John lives, and most people don't think of him as a city kid, right? They assume that he was born in Stockbridge or Arlington, Vermont. But he moved to those places later on. He did grow up in New York City, and he moved to New Rochelle, New York, at a young age. And at the time, it was a great illustrator colony. And his heroes lived in New Rochelle. All of this is so unimaginable right now, because it's really the kind of lost history. I actually grew up in New Rochelle, New York, so I had a great time going back to the New Rochelle Library and researching its history as an art colony. But all the great illustrators lived there in the 1920s. And those guys were, at that time in the 1920s, they did very well commercially. Because the 1920s, you think for one second about the 20s, you think money, prosperity, advertising, new household products, electricity, all these things being invented. There was a great need for advertising. And a lot of the illustrators became involved in that and made a lot of money, and also illustrated magazine covers, because we really didn't have a widespread use of photography at that point. So if you were an illustrator in the 20s and you got onto the cover of the Saturday Evening Post, that was a cool place to be. And Rockwell became very successful at an early age. He knew he wanted to be an artist. He was obsessed of getting to the Saturday Evening Post. And he got there. He published his first cover when he was young, when he was 21. So he is best known, of course. Let me back up a little. Okay, so he published magazine covers all through the 20s and all through the 30s. But with the outbreak of World War II, he felt like he wanted to do something larger. Something beyond mere magazine covers, and that's when he did his Four Freedoms. And I really love these paintings. Can you all see them? I know these are small images. But I'm amazed that he was able to make such memorable paintings about our goals in wartime. Because if you think of what art is about, it's usually about private struggle, right, individual sentiment and emotion. And to be able to make patriotic paintings that are memorable is hard to do. It's not inherently a romantic subject, right? Like, imagine if you had to make a painting about voting on Election Day. That's not a romantic subject, but he somehow was able to make paintings about everyday life in America, and especially civic life, the way we participate in society in a very memorable way. And the way he did that was by using regular people as his models. And that was really radical, because if you think about patriotic imagery in the past, like during World War I, when people made, if they wanted to make a patriotic poster during World War I, what's the most famous poster from World War I? Anyone here know? I Want You, by James Montgomery Flagg. And it's Uncle Sam, right, in his Stars and Stripes outfit. It was kind of a staple. He was a staple of patriotic imagery. He had been used in loads of patriotic posters over the years. But the idea of using your next door neighbors in a patriotic poster, think how radical that was. Instead of doing, you know, the Statue of Liberty and all those figures of victory and all those patriotic kind of figures that had existed throughout time. So anyway, so he used his neighbors to do the four freedoms, and I hope you could see, it's not the best reproduction. Freedom of speech is this one right here, and that's a man standing up to speak at a town hall meeting, and his neighbors look on very respectfully, and I love that painting. There's so much in Edward Rockwell. You could talk about any of them all day because there's such a wealth of interesting detail. But in that painting, in Freedom of Speech, I think it's interesting that he's a young man and his clothes are very different from everybody else in the picture because he's really wearing workman's clothing. He has a flannel shirt on, suede jacket, and his skin is kind of dark compared to other people who are listening to him. So I think he could possibly be an immigrant. He could, what did someone say?
He worked outdoors.
All right, somebody who worked with his hands. You feel that, in fact, his fingernails are kind of dirty. If you compare this hand, his hand, to this hand here, which is very white and has the wedding ring on it, and is it suggests a different class. Even though he's somebody who they may not be close friends with, the men in the town hall are listening to him very closely. They are turning their gaze towards him. They are looking at him and they are listening. And eyes and ears are very much, I think, very evident in this painting. Like this ear, right here, here. Okay, and the composition is triangular, so it adopts a kind of heroic Renaissance composition, the pyramid, in order to bestow more glory on this figure, the man, who kind of looks like Abraham Lincoln to me. I think he's supposed to look a little bit like Lincoln, kind of a lanky type of American hero. And I love that painting because it's about Americans listening to other Americans. Whether or not you agree completely with what that person is saying, it is about extending respect to the person who stands up to speak. And I think, you know, that's a moment that really has been lost right now in our culture because we're a very, I don't know, everyone's screaming. Nobody listens. There's too much screaming and not enough listening right now, I would say. And so I love that one, the town hall one. Some people, a lot of art historians consider this the best one. Can you see this? Freedom from Fear is the parents tucking their children into bed. It's a beautiful genre painting, I think. And actually the parents aren't really tucking their children into bed. This is what's fun about Rockwell's. You could really look at them and figure out exactly what moment he is depicting. The children are already asleep. So that tells you that parents are looking in on the children, which is different and tucking them in. It's a quieter moment. If you think of the satisfaction of watching children or grandchildren sleeping in their bed, you know how satisfying that is, isn't it? Watching children sleeping. You know, whereas tucking them in is not necessarily that peaceful. You know, to be reading another story, I mean, you go to children, you know, and it could be a chaotic moment. It could be a time of friction. The children don't want to go to sleep. You're exhausted. Okay, but looking in on sleeping children, I mean, has anybody else ever thought to paint that deep satisfaction? You know, you could really, it's just, and we've all had that moment. And it is, it's different than tucking them in. But this is a painting about safety. You know, everyone should be safe. During the war, the father is holding a newspaper whose headlines report the bombing of London. And the doll on the floor, there's a doll who looks like she's been through war, as opposed to hint at sort of the violence outside the bedroom. And I, you know, it's the ultimate image of security. In this country, I think it remains so. I don't think anyone has surpassed it. This one, freedom from want, with the giant turkey. I always liked that one a lot, but it's kind of a jokey painting. It's a little different than the others. I always love this figure turning out to wink at us, as if to say, you know, I love my traditions, but there's something a little silly about them. When this painting was shown in Russia, the Russians were really offended by the size of the turkey and took it as a sign of America's greed, which is odd to us. And to us, it all looks like perfect turkey, right? Perfect Thanksgiving turkey. And the models in the painting, to give you a little bit of information about Rockwell's technique, all pose separately. They're not his actual family. And he sketched them one at a time and then inserted them into the painting. That's what he always did. So that scene never existed in reality. He conceived all these scenes in his head, and then would have people come in and pose for them one by one. He liked to work from life. He liked to work from models. But scenes like this, he never actually had four people gathered to enact the scene. Instead, he would do the father one day, the mother another day, the children another day. And he had a very, very painstaking and involved technique. I wonder, can we get another image up or not? I was just going to quickly say that he, in many ways, defined our values during World War II. These paintings were reproduced on posters during the Second World War. And then the government got involved, and anybody who bought a war bond got a free set of these posters. And they raised zillions of dollars. This was at a time when Americans believed, can we get the Ruby Bridges painting? It's called The Problem We All Lived With. This was at a time when Americans believed that if you fought a war, you should pay for it. Unlike now, you know, where we just go and declare war. Have we what?
Don't declare war.
No. Don't declare war at all. But in those days, Americans, you know, Morgenthau was head of the Treasury, Roosevelt was president. Americans really believed they had to raise money, pay for their own wars. And so those posters were sold to help sell war bonds and raised a lot for World War II. Okay, this is a copy of the painting. I wonder, should I try to do this? It's not exactly the painting. What's interesting to me is that Rockwell, we had such a talent for defining the national consciousness. And much as he defined our goals during World War II, he was able to do it again in the 1960s. And the 60s were a decade that were almost the opposite of World War II in some ways, the war era, because in World War II, the message was we could all come together, right, as Americans, and that we were better than other people because we had such a strong sense of right and wrong, and we had good values. And then in the 1960s, of course, it was a time of enormous self. That's it. That's great. No, not that one. This one, exactly. Can we make that bigger? Great. Then in the 60s, of course, it was a time of enormous internal conflict, criticism, and coming apart as opposed to coming together. And Rockwell was there to capture that moment beautifully, too. In the 60s, he did some great civil rights paintings. And this one has actually been around a lot lately because this is the 50th anniversary of the passage of the Civil Rights Act, which was passed in 1964. When Rockwell did this painting, it shows Ruby Bridges, a little black girl, who was sent to a school in New Orleans in order to desegregate the schools. And at the time, as I'm sure many of you remember, the white children all left the school. And they didn't want to go to school with Ruby. Their parents pulled them out of school, so she went every day escorted by federal marshals. And this image, it's interesting, has really become the defining image of the civil rights movement. There is no other painting. You can look at the pop artist, Warhol, everybody who was active in the 60s. Some of them did do anti-war work, but this is the image we turn to when we want to remember that era. If there was one painting, it's this one. And I love that he cut off the heads of the federal marshals in the pictures. He's letting us know they're really not important compared to this little girl who is bravely in the world all by herself. And he wrote the N-word up on that wall to capture all the discrimination in the world. And the smashed tomato is also a symbol of all the hostility that had been directed her way. In terms of his personal life, Rockwell, I learned, was pretty much as tormented as any artist who ever lived. He was very insecure, worried that nothing he ever did was good enough, and really tormented himself with his own shortcomings. And he was married 3 times. He had difficult marriages. He had 3 sons. He had not always easy relationships with his children. And he finally moved to Stockbridge in 1953 to be treated by Eric Erickson, who was a great analyst who had studied with Anna Freud and was really one of the great analysts of the 20th century. And of course, he kept all that fairly quiet during his lifetime. But he and Eric Erickson were very close, and Eric Erickson would treat him in his studio. He would visit him in the studio, and they would have psychiatric sessions that were almost like studio sessions, where Rockwell would show him his painting and say, is this good? Is this done? What does this mean? And Erickson would discuss his work with him. But he was a very needy man. He was afraid to be alone. He felt weak himself and easily burdened, even though his public persona was always very folksy and cheerful. The American public loved seeing him on TV or on radio. He had a very nice way about him, but privately certainly suffered, I think, as much as any artist who gives himself over to his work. So let's see, should we start taking questions?
Or are you going to speak about the one of those 4 paintings in the northeast quadrant?
Oh,
you didn't get to that one.
Oh, okay. Should we go back to that? That's freedom of worship. Sure. You're very observant. The 4th freedom. Freedom of worship. Norman Rockwell. Right, that's the 4th freedom. That's a copy of it, that's not the original. Can we get the original? Right, that's it. Okay, it's hard to see, isn't it? Yes. Okay, this is freedom of, whoa. credo worship, and it's a bunch of people facing in the same direction. They're all praying, and they represent different religions. So you could see one woman is holding, for instance, rosary beads. Oh, that, she's, wait, can we see it in her hands? Yes, right here, this woman is holding a string of rosary beads in her hand, and the young man in the upper right is supposed to be Jewish. And it's a very early attempt to bring together people of different faiths into one work. You know, later, remember when Pepsi, what was the big, was it Coke? What was the big commercial? And teach the world to sing. And they would bring together people on a hillside from all different backgrounds. I really think that started in Rockwell's work. He did many works in which he would bring together people from different ethnicities or religions. It's not my favorite composition, which is probably why I skipped it. I find it too crowded. There are too many heads in a flat space. And it's very different than his other scenes, which tend to be anecdotal. Here he's not telling a story. This feels more like a manifesto. He's saying, this is what life should be. We should all be able to respect each other's religion and worship, not quite together, then respect one another's religion. So it's not a story, this painting, right? It's not anecdotal like his other work. And I prefer the anecdotal paintings, although, of course, the sentiment behind this is as worthy as a sentiment could be.
It's very different from the others.
It's very different, right? Because there's no story. Right?
Crowded.
A little airless. It's also pretty radical in that. Look at how he painted this woman's hands. You know, he took so much pleasure in painting flesh. And I think it's really admirable that he was painting older people in addition to younger people. Because he's also capturing an America where old people are part of everyday life, you know, where they were able to connect to every other generation, where all generations were equal. And that's something I think we've lost in America as well, in our obsession with youth culture. Questions? Yes.
Yeah, I was wondering if you could comment on his explicit political commitments. Because I've always seen Rockwell as lending himself too readily to a type of right-wing populism, if not chauvinism. And clearly there's a progressive sensibility in terms of civil rights, but there's no critique of the status quo, really. And he just seems to lend himself, again, to this type of right-wing, always good about America, sensibility, which frankly is given where I come from. I've always seen a type of turnoff. And I'm wondering if you could biographically talk about.
Right, right. No, it's a really interesting point because, you know, you find him appropriated by the right and the left. You know, everybody can use them to further their cause. Okay, was he right-wing? And now, some would say, you know, that he is that a defender of an all-white or mostly all-white America where everything is good and there are no problems. I would argue, well, actually, you asked about his personal politics. Let me start with that. In his youth, when he was young, he registered as a Republican, as his father had been. He described himself as a moderate Republican. And the Republican Party was so different then, like in the teens and in the 1920s, that being a registered Republican in that era, I don't think made him anything like a right-winger. What do you think of? You agree?
Yeah.
Good, because I don't want to have to argue that point. I feel very strongly about that. That he was not that political generally, and that he was a great believer in tolerance. Later on, he became very liberal. But he also became liberal, this was in the 1950s, and he became involved with liberal politics through the nuclear disarmament movement. By then he was living in Stockbridge, he was very close to his shrink, Eric Erickson, who was a big liberal, and there were a lot of intellectuals living in Stockbridge at the time. And that's because the Austin Riggs Hospital is based there. So that attracted, at the time, a lot of the leading shrinks in the United States. It was a very interesting community. Also, everybody knows there's lots of arts in that area. So you had actors, you had poets. It was just a great community. And it was very, various people there were involved in nuclear disarmament. So that's how he became involved, I would say, with leftist politics. And then he was completely absorbed by the civil rights movement and was a great promoter of equality. I noticed also that he was a lifelong member of the NAACP. He joined in the early 60s. And I think he was always a great promoter of tolerance. His third wife, Molly Punderson, was a really impressive woman. She was quite old when he married her. They were both about 65. She was retired from teaching school at Milton Academy, and she was very, very liberal, and no doubt influenced him also. But I think in terms of the reading of his work, he said, isn't, you know, you're turned off by the all-white homogeneity, trying to pronounce that, of the work. Why is he creating this all-white world where everything's okay? I would argue, I read a lefty message in his work, and I'll tell you why. I think it's really about deriving the meaning of your life from a community. It's not each man for his own. It's about feeling embraced by a community. And to be an American, to him meant, it's true, you know that somebody will greet you on Thanksgiving. You have a table to return to, but you also are part of a city and a country that will support you and respect you. And I mean, one could make the argument even that his work supports public welfare, because it's all about helping people in the community. We take care of each other. And I think that's really a liberal view. Basically, the work is very communitarian. It doesn't matter whether you call it left or right, but it is, you know, because you could argue it either way. But I think there's no denying that he really, really found a lot of consolation in the idea of community. He was not very good at personal relationships, and his work is not about personal relationships. It's really about people you meet at the store when you go to the market, or about voting for president, and being part of a democracy. So I see that. I can easily argue that the work is liberal. Yes?
I was at the Rockwell Museum last week, and there's a big exhibit there now by Edward Hopper. Mm-hmm. And there's a big quotation of Hopper's on the wall. He said, "I am an illustrator. As an illustrator, I cannot paint what I want. I have to please the magazine editor and the public." Do you think that Rockwell felt the same way?
Yeah, I mean, if you're an illustrator or a journalist, or all of us have had jobs at some point, you're working for someone else, and to some extent carrying out their vision of the world. But I think that, first of all, two things. Rockwell, unlike most illustrators, never was unable to paint without a deadline. Okay, so a lot of times he would try and say, "Oh, enough of this. I need to quit the Saturday Evening Post. It's not creative. It's not real art." He would go off to Paris. He would try to lean on his imagination, and he couldn't do it for a lot of reasons. But all right, so all he did was illustration, and in that sense, I don't think, like Hopper, he was eager to break away from illustration. But also, I think that I think his illustrations kind of do double duty. They served as magazine covers, and in the best tradition of American art, they're kind of a quick read. Like, if you walk by one on your newsstand, you get the joke in 10 seconds, and you could keep on walking and chuckle over the joke. Or, I say they do double duty because you can go back and look at them, and it's amazing how much looking they invite and sustain. So in that sense, it's fascinating to me that all these years after his death, we are still talking about his work. They've held our interest as much as any abstract painting of their era certainly has. And So did he resent doing illustrations? Yes, but somehow, fortunately, he expended so much care on them that they have the staying power of art. It was not something he could even know during his lifetime. It's only because we now know it's almost 40 years after his death and we're still talking about the work and it still holds meaning for us that we are able to say the work rises above the level of illustration. He couldn't know that in his lifetime. It's not something you can know in your lifetime if you're an artist. You have no idea whether your work is going to survive or not. And I'm sure he did not expect his work to survive. Why would it have? None of the older illustrators did too well, like his hero Howard Pyle, who did Pirates. It's funny, I just found a first edition book of Howard Pyle's Pirates in a used bookstore, and I bought it for $10. And I thought if this were a first edition book, a Picasso or Matisse, it would be selling for thousands of dollars. A lot of illustrators that he loved have been quite forgotten.
Don't you think that he represents our ideals, how we would like the United States to be? That's why I could be Republican or Democrat. It doesn't make any difference. Mm-hmm. I think they're all human qualities, actually universal qualities that people all over the world would like.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Definitely. You could also argue, though, very good question. Doesn't he represent an idealized vision of civic life? Aren't these the values that we hope society would promote and protect? Yeah, I think so. But they're very much a comment on our public life. His work, I find it more a comment on our public life than our private life. And it's precisely our public life that is in so much trouble now in this country. In terms of, again, all the shrieking and lack of listening and misunderstandings and the widening income gap in this country. So I find that what he is preaching and advocating for our public life is still very relevant as a vision. I think it's still something we might aspire to. John?
There are still a handful of people who were models for him at Stockbridge.
Yes.
I'm wondering if in your research you talked to any of them as part of your research and what you learned about him as an individual, as a neighbor, etc.
It really varied. Some models worship him and some are just furious that they had to stand still with their head bent for 30 minutes until they had a crick in their neck. It's hard work posing for artists, but I got the whole range of emotions. Some people, you know, just revered him, and others felt that he was cold and was just using them for a pose. So
he paid them, didn't he?
He did pay them. He always paid his models. How do you know that? But then, you know, some would get bitter because it's so complicated with the models. God. Okay, at the beginning, he kept a stack of quarters in his studio. And every 30 minutes, he would give the kids, a child model, another 25 cents in the hope that they would have some motivation to continue. He found that worked better than writing checks because a check is kind of abstract to a child model. He always did pay very generously. He paid all his help very generously. He had a lot of help. He always needed, he's someone who loved having a lot of help around. And I was really glad when I learned how well he paid everybody. Because, you know, nobody likes the stereotype of a stingy New Englander. And so I was just thrilled when people said that he, you know, he was writing checks to everybody. Anyone who helped him in any way, he was very happy to either give them a work, he gave away a lot of his own work, or reward them somehow or another. He did not take advantage of people who helped him.
Over here.
Oh, yes.
I felt that your comments about the man at the town meeting, I was interested and glad that the people were listening. But I always got the feeling that what he was trying to
enforced and explained about was the freedom to stand up and say it in the first place. Not so much that wonderful the people were listening, but the man knew that in a day and age of so much repression and wars and everything and people that could not, I felt that the purpose of the whole thing was that he could stand up and say it.
Well, I would say that's the traditional idea about a town hall meeting. I mean, town hall meetings go back to the beginnings of American democracy, right? That was when this country was founded in New England, and if you go back to those early New England meetings, those were town hall meetings in which anyone can stand up and speak, and that became the definition of democracy. Okay, so that's definitely part of it, but I would argue that Rockwell does it in his own way by focusing on the eyes and the ears and showing that not only can anybody speak, but that Americans will listen, and that's what knits us together as a country, this ability to look at other people and to hear other people. So I think he improvises on the theme a little bit. I mean, he does have, it's not just a man standing up, it's also the people around him who are so receptive.
Don't you think that's what we're missing now is we're listening?
Oh, my God. It's unbelievable. Have you all seen, you know, those photographs out of Missouri? The police with the guns, have you been following? I mean, it's just, you know, you look at those photographs and you think, how did Middle America become a war zone? Why are we aiming guns at each other? Yes?
I was wondering if you researched any of the politics involved in the old corner house of the original museum of Rockwell's and the politics that went into creating the new museum in the Glendale area.
You sound like you were involved.
I did have a house there at the time.
What did you do at the time?
I did have a house.
You had a house in Stockbridge. Yeah. Well, I think, you know, Molly, his third wife, the one who was very, very smart, the retired school teacher, who had never been married before. No one in Stockbridge could believe it when she said she was marrying him because he was this eligible bachelor. His previous wife had died tragically, had been rather miserable and taken a lot of drugs and was an alcoholic and had a lot of problems. So then he married Molly, the level-headed school teacher, actually a brilliant woman, and it was her idea really to start collecting his paintings for a museum. And I'm indebted to her for that, because this isn't exactly answering your question, but it was Molly who had the idea and the focus and the discipline to do it. And if she hadn't done that, who knows where his paintings would be today? Because unlike other artists' work, these paintings were not going into any museums. None of the New York museums were collecting Rockwell. I mean, you can't see a Rockwell in New York City. It's really interesting. And, you know, the Met has one painting, and they won't show it. It gets me very angry. I have a campaign for them to show. They have a study for freedom of speech, a study of the man standing up that has even more people listening to them. And they don't hang it up. They just don't show it. It's in storage. So, you know, if the Rockwell Museum hadn't been there, and we could assume that his paintings would not have been acquired by the Met or the Whitney Museum or the Guggenheim or the Museum of Modern Art, who knows if they would even exist? They could have been thrown away or damaged or lost. Paintings do get lost and do disappear over time. So I think it's incredible that the third wife had the foresight to start a museum. And so that way, you know, even though his reputation has gone in and out of style, you could say over the years, the paintings are there. They're there if we want to return to them. They're there in Stockbridge. And we do have most of his work.
Well, I think that begs a question, though, about another illustrator named Hopper, who didn't ever get a museum of that size and quality for his work.
Right.
Was that because the value of his work is less or more or not?
No, okay.
So it was a town decision.
Right. But Hopper didn't need a museum because Hopper is at, all his work is at the Whitney Museum of American Art.
It's about the only place, so.
No, it's everywhere. Everywhere. I just had a piece in the Times last weekend about the Delaware Art Museum, which has an incredible Edward Hopper. Everybody has a Hopper or wants a Hopper. He was always pretty popular because he gave up illustration. He began his career as a magazine illustrator, but broke away from that and did fine art painting. What is the difference? You can ask, the difference is, if you're a fine art painter, you are showing your work in art galleries. You're not publishing it on magazine covers. So the difference is mainly one in audience, I would say, as opposed to in nature of the work. Okay, an illustrator is happy to have his paintings on the cover of the Saturday Evening Post. A fine artist wants to have his paintings at the Museum of Modern Art. Rockwell did not really have gallery shows. He was offered them all the time. He didn't want to get involved. He wasn't about that. He was a true populist. He wanted to work for the general public. And it cost him, in terms of art world admiration. And Hopper doesn't need his own museum. Hopper is everywhere. And the Museum of Modern Art has a few great Hoppers, but the Whitney Museum has the most. And a lot of them are hanging right now upstairs on the top floor because the Whitney is planning to move to Lower Manhattan now. And they put up some hits from the permanent collection. Yes?
I have two questions. The first one has to do with one thing, sir, at least I always thought when I was a little girl at my grandmother's apartment, I would wait for the Saturday Evening Post to come to see the new Norman Rockwell. I think of the two as going hand in hand. What was the business nature of that relationship? Was he on retainer? Was the picture lucrative contract? Was there a minimum guarantee? How did that work?
Yeah, the question is, what was his relationship with the Saturday Evening Post? What was his business relationship? And I could talk about that forever, because there's so much interesting detail. He did not want a contract. They paid him by the piece, and he was just on the cover about once a month. It was a weekly magazine. He would have the cover about once a month, and those issues always sold out. The Saturday Evening Post would increase its press run whenever he was on the cover. And it's led to huge legal problems since his death, because, first of all, believe it or not, the Post still has the copyright on every painting they've reproduced. Don't ask me why. So if I want to reproduce, when a newspaper, when the New York Times reproduces a Norman Rockwell painting, they have to pay the Saturday Evening Post. And the Saturday Evening Post doesn't even exist anymore, except to charge these very high rates for the reproduction of Rockwell paintings. That is their sole source of income, basically. And I wish someone would sue them. And I pleaded with the Rockwell children, saying, please sue the Post and get the copyright away from them. Because really, what they were buying from Rockwell was the right to reproduce a cover once. They weren't getting the painting. They did not get the paintings, right? They wanted to use it on the cover. It's crazy. Yeah, so they're still in control of the copyright. If you want to publish a Rockwell in a newspaper or a magazine. And when I did one piece for the Times about Rockwell for the Arts and Leisure section, it was at the time that Steven Spielberg and George Lucas were showing their collection in Washington. They were both avid collectors of his work. And at that time, the Post wanted so much to reproduce the Rockwells that the New York Times could not afford it.
Oh my God.
And we couldn't do it. And they said, you know, we're just going to use images in the public domain. Okay, what does that mean? Does anyone know when images?
75 years?
Now it's 90. So it's up to 1924. So any image that you see in a magazine that was published before 1924, you can reproduce. You could put it in your book, you could put it on a book jacket, you don't owe anyone 10 cents. Okay? And so now we're up to 1924. I'm very conscious of that, because every year I think, now what images can I reproduce this year that I couldn't reproduce last year? If you want to reproduce anything after 1924, you need the permission of the copyright holder, which usually is the artist or the artist's family. Should we take one more question? I don't want people to start falling asleep. Have you? I don't know. You? All right, we'll take these three. Go ahead quickly.
Some of his
art portraits resembled photographs.
Photographs.
Did he use?
He did use photographs. Once photography came along, all the illustrators used photographs, but he would usually use about 100 photographs or more per figure. So he would take a lot of pictures and reassemble parts in his own compositions. But he did, it was very useful to him as a kind of memory aid. Okay?
It seems to me that I've seen the picture of the little girl with a frieze of screaming people around the base of the painting. Is that just my crazy memory?
That's very interesting. You're talking about the Ruby Bridges painting. Yes. I think he kind of suggests the crowd without actually showing it.
Maybe silhouettes, but you know, people screaming.
No. He never painted that because he deliberately he left the haters out of the painting.
That was in the newspaper this morning.
I'm sure. Picture?
Yeah.
Right. Similar. People. Right. That's true. Might be thinking of a photograph. You're right. Yes.
He is in many of his paintings. I don't know if you realize that. You can pick him out. He could be in the corner. I'm wondering if the one with the turkey and the man was winking. He didn't have glasses on.
It looks like him. A lot of people thought that was him, but he did use a model for that figure.
Yeah. But so many of the paintings, if you study them, he's in the corner where you can barely see him. And he admitted that he puts himself in.
Yeah, it's a kind of amusing device and thing. Okay, so thank you so much all for coming. And I wish you all the best and lots of warm and Rockwell-like serenity for the rest of the summer and the days ahead.
All right, thank you very much, Ms. Sullivan. Geer is very fortunate. We have one of our employees, actually Ruby Bridges was the cousin of one of our employees, and she was the model for that. It's so ingrained here in the area. So thank you very, very much, Deborah.